Hello, everybody. I'm Rob Wallace here in St. Paul, Minnesota. I'm an evolutionary epidemiologist with the People CDC, here with an update on the COVID-19 pandemic. This week, we'll cover the state of global COVID, the state of U.S. COVID, and along the way, some of the evidence that refutes President Biden's pronouncement this week that the pandemic is over. We begin with global COVID. In the graph in red, the Johns Hopkins Coronavirus Resource Center reports a slight decrease to 3.4 million new confirmed COVID cases worldwide for the week ending September 18th. The number of global weekly deaths, there in white, declined to 11,500 confirmed deaths this past week. In green, we see a decrease to 33.5 million new vaccinations administered this week worldwide. This New York Times map shows hotspots over the past week in Europe and Asia. There in purple, Slovenia, South Korea, and Taiwan remain epicenters in average daily new cases per 100,000 population. Austria has now newly re-entered that category. Japan has exited it, and South America and Australia continue their welcome declines in caseloads. At the same time, we see from these percent changes in caseloads the past couple weeks that rebounds there in the warm colors burble about the globe, including Nicaragua, Suriname, and the Dominican Republic and the Americas. Suddenly, Europe, particularly France, Central Asia, Bangladesh, and Myanmar, and the West and South African clusters we pointed out last week. A welcome global retraction does not necessarily represent the end of a pandemic when the virus survives in redoubts from which it launches new attacks, particularly when most of the world's countries are half-assing their non-pharmaceutical interventions, like mask mandates, as shown here by the Containment and Health Index. Most countries are at only around 50% on the index. At a time when a goodly portion of the world is still unvaccinated for even a single dose, particularly Africa, Eastern Europe, and parts of the Middle East and Central Asia, or at best vaccinated for variants no longer really circulating. We see other than Chile, the large countries we spotlighted are lagging in administering any of the booster shots, with almost nothing in low-income countries in Africa, but also near nothing in Russia and a mediocre campaign in the US. And at a time when multiple Omicron subvariants are circulating across large expanses of the world, BA1, BA2, BA2.75, BA4, and BA5. And new subvariants are rapidly emerging as we enter a likely winter spike, if previous COVID years are any indication. Candidate subvariants include BJ.1, BH1, BA2.3, BA2.10, BA2.76, BA4.6, and BAQ.1, among many others. Along with this zoo of new subvariants, the virus is surging in its molecular evolution. Some commentators have noted a recent rapid acceleration in the number of new amino acid substitutions in Omicron's receptor binding domain. That's a part of the spike protein that allows SARS-2 to key into the locks on our cells. And as new work by evolutionary biochemist Tyler Starr's group shows, the impact of these replacements can certainly lurch depending on the stereochemical changes, the changes in the molecule's 3D shape happening in other parts of the protein. From the original Wuhan strain at the top there, down to the Eta strain, there were already so many of such changes. Now, most of those changes across the receptor domain there in brown made it harder for the virus to grasp onto our cell. But some there in blue made it easier. The point is that even a new low of less than 4 million new global cases this week is still bad news. All those cases allow SARS-2 vast room to conduct its own viral experiments on us, including devising new ways by which to pick our cells' locks. In this case, the STAR team showed one way the receptor binding domain linked with our ACE2 cell receptor under the original Wuhan strain changed to entirely new strategy under Omicron, from a stable three-way polar interaction in the Wuhan strain to dynamic salt bridging in Omicron. Such shifts may impact our real-world immunity. As computational virologist Ben Muir reports, the BA2.75 subvariant there on the right in red is escaping our antibody response better than any variant so far. So contrary to U.S. President Joe Biden's proclamation this week, the pandemic is clearly not over. Although assuming such declarations are useful, one wonders why he hasn't issued others for the end of HIV and climate change. protesters, many disabled or suffering long COVID, blocked traffic this week near the White House because they do not have the luxury of such magical thinking. With SARS-2, more a vascular disease damaging whole organ systems, hitting all those ACE2 receptors that are studied all across our bodies. Other people can afford such magical thinking. As Steve Thrasher, author of The Viral Underclass, observed, the 4,000 Americans COVID still killing every week are four times the deaths at the peak of the AIDS epidemic here in the US. Not that we're setting one neglected pandemic against another, the point here is to provide a yardstick of the continuing damage that COVID-19 still imposes upon the US at this, a supposed ebb in the outbreak. Continuing with the US, we see the country presently remains moving in two different directions. On the one hand, this New York Times map shows much of the country continued its steady decline in caseloads per 100,000. The Northeast, Upper Midwest, the coastal Southeast, the Rockies, and much of the West Coast are presently characterized by a relative decline in COVID. The Plain State still hosts pinpricks of counties still badly hit by outbreaks, but those Oklahoma, Nebraska, and South Dakota clusters we spotted last week appear to be resolving. On the other hand, in a different direction, Appalachia, West Virginia, Kentucky, and Southern Ohio continue to be a COVID stronghold. We are forced to take these metrics at face value, but it doesn't help that hospitals and health departments are following the administration on adhering to looser reporting standards, and that home testing isn't reportable. Still, looking at this, it's presently a bit of better news. Whether it serves as the basis of calling the pandemic over is entirely another matter, especially with more recent reports of new upticks in cases and deaths and what has been an annual winter surge. Indeed, the levels of SARS-2 virus detected in the wastewater that comes through our sewage plants, as reported here September 4th through 18th, a leading indicator of the pandemic, indicate ongoing hotspots remain more widely dispersed than the caseload map indicates. Sewage plants in red represent loads at 80 to 100% more than their previously recorded levels. We see these scattered across the US, including places that the previous map showed were cooling off: Nebraska, Illinois, Michigan, Northern Ohio, upstate and downstate New York, and some plants farther south. We do see cooled off blues continue to characterize the West Coast, Missouri, Texas, and Florida. But the change in sewage caseloads over the past 15 days may indicate something else. We see here in red flare-ups of 1,000% or more of SARS-2 detected in Southern California, Colorado, Michigan, parts of Appalachia, and throughout New York State, except New York City. The wastewater isn't just catching variants of concern like the various Omicron subvariants we listed before. Molecular virologist Mark Johnson reports his team found in St. Louis wastewater all sorts of what he calls cryptic lineages with previously unidentified amino acid changes. Much as we describe at the global level, evolution burbles along at every local spot too, experimenting with a variety of new molecular traits. Maybe these were contributed by other infected species, Johnson surmised, but it's unlikely, he concluded. He collaborated with virologist David O'Connor to track back Wisconsin cryptic lineages through the literal pipeline to a specific restroom. Evolution is found wherever shit happens. To sum up, here's the People CDC version of our present community transmission by county, mapped by our own Les Schaffer. It's the combo of caseloads and test positivity that the CDC plots, but unlike the CDC, the People CDC differentiates the high level of danger counties are subjected to beyond 10% COVID positivity into high, very high, and extremely high. Down at the bottom, we see that the People CDC also now differentiates exposure by both the percent of counties and by the percent population. We see here that population, we're down to 77% of the American people are in communities subjected to high to extremely high COVID exposure, the latter particularly across Appalachia, Virginia, and spots throughout the Plains states. The decline is welcome news, but it still means the far majority of the American people are in places of at least high exposure, even as the White House declares the pandemic over. The problem of a lesser sense of how high or still high caseloads are and where they are exactly is combined with a virus that continues to evolve. BA5 continues to dominate new cases at 85%, but BA4.6 is starting to pick up speed to 11%. And now suddenly we're picking up B7 and B2.75. all the reason to join long COVID survivors demanding the Biden administration address their needs, including preventing infections in the first place. They represent only a few of the as many as 23 million Americans suffering long COVID. 23 million and counting. And that's COVID this week from the People's CDC. You can learn more about the People's CDC and read this week's COVID weather report at our revamped website, peoplecdc.org.